I start with the self-introduction. Normally, conference like to invite me because when I show up, they can check off three countries. As you see, I was born in China, China born, and Canadian, and living in Sweden. See that the three countries can check off now, huh? Okay. Oh, it's not seem to be responding. Yeah. So most of my time I worked in Ericsson. A little bit over 20 years, 20.7 years. And yeah, okay. And where I had the opportunity to work from pretty much end to the other end. So I worked as a product manager, project manager, system architect, developer, you know, programmer, tester, integrator, troubleshooter, customer support. So, and then also, back in 2008, and one of the largest organizations was transforming in Ericsson. And then with their experience, they started to realize it would be so much more efficient to actually have our own internal coaches because the product was huge. How huge was it? It was over 2,000 people in seven different countries with two supplier organizations. And then the coaches, they brought in, and as you could imagine, saw the product, confused, overwhelmed with the complexity of the product, maybe a little bit politics as well, organization structure, everything was quite confusing. So therefore, in 2009, they were looking for candidates with end-to-end competence. As you can imagine, I was not so many people who have that background. So therefore, I did my career transition from a technical person to full-time Agile coach. Then I found my new passion. So since then, I have been doing Agile coaching different organizations, and then I was heading Ericsson Global Transformation Support Center, also growing coaches all over the world to support Ericsson to transform. Yeah. And then in 2017, that's the year I did a new chapter because my fiance is Swedish. And so I've been doing this Canada, Sweden, equally cold. equally dark as well, almost. And so in the end, I moved to Sweden. I said, you know, over 20 years in the same company, maybe time to open a new chapter. So I did. So I started my own coaching, training, and consulting company in 2017. And then I walked on from one Friday, leaving telecom company. Monday, I walked into automotive company. So since then, I've been coaching different clients from automotive industry to banking, insurance company, and pretty much that's what I do now. Yeah. So I do coaching, training, and the coaching is really my passion. And so I'm one of the few who have a certified team coach, certified enterprise coach globally. And also, from technical person, I felt the need to develop my coaching skill. So therefore, I'm also a certified team coach, a certified performance coach, executive coach, master coach on the professional coaching side as well. Additionally, I also do some certification training, certified Scrum. Many of you, I would assume, have certified Scrum Master. Yeah, okay. And then also, I do Agile leadership. I brainwash managers, executives. So that's pretty much about me. And then, so what am I going to speak about? So I have been coaching different organizations, even back the days in Ericsson, seemed to be one company, but so many people, so many different cultures, so many different products. And then also walking into automotive, insurance, and banking, and the other type of clients they have. And there are some common patterns I start to see more and more. And there are many, many, many new practices out there, and that's what I call a few inspiration, just examples. There are many. Yeah, there are many new inspirations, and I also see some challenges as well. So that's what we will be looking at today. So therefore, then we talk about the inspiration practice, then we zoom into the practice, and hopefully we take some learning out of it. And then we summarize with some takeaway messages. And then now let's take a look at inspiration number one. As we know that with Agile, we start to focus more, finally start to think about the customer, which is fantastic, which is great. And more companies are doing interviews with customer now. Okay, we understand the importance to have customer focus, to talk to customer, and then many companies start to do problem interview, empathy interview. However, we're going to zoom into the practice to see exactly what's being done. And we have all probably very likely have read the book Lean Startup. Yeah. And then we know the circle, yeah? Build, measure, learn. So we're going to talk a bit about that as well. And also we are all familiar with the concept of A-B testing, split testing, hypothesis testing. So we're going to look into that also. And then talking into hypothesis testing, some of you might have heard Google years ago, they tested 41 different shades of blue. Yeah. And for some of you interested to know more, I can Google, you'll find it quickly. And then also, you probably have heard also Yahoo, they tested 30 different logos. Yeah. So that's certainly inspiration. Also, particularly with Google, they came up also with data to say, now that they found the perfect shade of blue, and then actually improved their advertisement revenue by 200 million. So certainly great inspiration as well. And then Spotify, all of us were inspired, yeah? So then we're gonna take a look at Spotify as well and see what are some practices are out there and by the inspiration of Spotify. Yeah? And then we're gonna take a look at value stream mapping. Many of you probably start to realize the more we want to improve, the more we want to look into some lean value principle and practices and value stream mapping from hardware, from manufacturer, taking that into an organization is indeed very beneficial. I'm going to look into that as well. And then flow. So finally, also given that back actually now about 15, 16 years ago, many of the large organizations before that, and they say, for instance, 1990-ish, early 2000, big organization, they always had the product management together with R&D or with IT. And then years after 2000, there were some consultancy companies start to recommend, oh, to be focused, so you should have product management and R&D. So now what happened? Siloed structure started. And then, so therefore, now we're focusing more again on customer. Now we say, well, it'd be nice to have some value flow from customer, order to cash. Yeah, that's all great. So therefore, we're going to talk about some inspiration around value flow and also look at practices as well. Okay, so now let's zoom in to the practices. So first one, let's zoom in. Customer interview. Yeah, and then here, a little exercise for you. I hope through the exercise Yannis organized just now, we warm up. So now what you do, you don't need to stand up, you don't need to move. What you do is that you discuss with a partner on your left side.
Everybody turns to the left.
Yeah, or the last person, hopefully you don't. And then think about which question below is a good customer interview question, and now I assume I build a sports app that's called Run Riga. That's our product name. Assume we're going to do a customer interview for our sports app, which is called Run Riga. And then I will have a few questions, then you guys can, two of you, hopefully not with the wall, you can discuss. And which one could be a good question? Yeah? So here, do you have a partner to talk to? Okay. Great, okay. Okay. So here's the first question, and how often do you do exercise? Remember, our product is called Run Riga, so therefore it's a sports app. So therefore, the first question, how often do you do exercise? Question one. And B, what new features would you recommend us to add? Number two, or B, Three, how do you feel about us adding a new feature to notify you when it's time to exercise? Number three. Number four, what do you feel about our product Riga, run Riga? In case you're using it already, how do you feel about it? Yeah, number four. Five, what factors do you consider when you select a sports app? Okay, so it's A, B, C, D, E. So now have a quick discussion, roughly about a minute and a half. Then we will be looking at it together. Yeah? So thank you for the hot discussion. So if you hold on to that curiosity slightly, let's look at what we have next. And customer interview. So we want to get closer to customer to understand their behavior, to understand their need, to understand their challenges. So we want to understand their real behavior, real challenges. Yeah. So now let's take a look. And here, there's more questions. Then now we can take a look at this one by one. Then we're going to go back to the previous A, B, C, D, E. Yeah. So here, there are questions. And would you feel $10 per month is too expensive? Would it be easier to exercise if there is a personal trainer program? Oops. Okay, would you use this new product? How do you feel about, in general, these three questions compared with the previous five?
More detail.
How do you feel? Okay. And so now, I always ask, when I do workshop coaching program, I'm always a little bit tricky with questions. So now you take a look. Some even worse questions these are. So first, let's take a look what's wrong with these questions. Number one, during the interview, and you never talk about pricing with customer. That's number one. Oops. It's going by itself? Okay. Now you know the questions more. Okay, so number one, during interview, you don't ask pricing related questions, and number two, normally you try not to ask guiding questions. What is a guiding question? Number two, certainly it is. Would it be easier to exercise if there is? And then what happened? Yeah, it would be easier. And what's going to happen? You build it, they're not going to use it. And next one, would you use this new product? Yeah, that's even worse, as you imagine. Why people, in general, are polite? And number two, thinking about it now, yeah, it could be useful, yes. And then what happened? So I have a story about a real client. So I went in, I was talking about customer interview. So all of them, they were nodding. Yeah, we're doing customer interview. We have been doing it since 2013, you see? And I said, okay, great, okay. So I said, tell me about that product. And then they said, oh, the product, we actually don't understand. You know, we did customer interview, we did pretty much everything you talked about, but our product, there was no user. Okay, so while they were pulling their computer for their interview question, I started to talk about a few things you should not do during an interview. And then they said, okay, we don't need to look at the question anymore. Oh, everything you said we should not do, we did. And it's when the product was targeted for government offices. So they interviewed a different government office with guiding questions, with questions such as, would you need this? Would you like to use it? Yes, yes, yes. And product was delivered, a few million euros were spent, and zero user, no user. They tried to promote for 8 months, and then they decided to park it completely. Yeah. Okay, so now, let's go back to better questions. Yeah. So now we go back to what we saw just now. How often do you exercise? You see, there is a little problem with the way we think about ourselves and the real me. See, the me I see for myself is always a little better. So if I ask me, how often do you exercise? Some of you might say, yeah, I do 5 times a week. Yeah, and then what happened? Now if I ask you another question, how many times did you exercise last week? 2 times. Yeah, so there's a difference. Yeah, very important. Remember, interview help us to understand customer behavior. Yeah, not the ideal you. And next one, what new features would you recommend for us to use? If you ask that question, people are nice, people try to help, and people start to think, yeah, I think that would help. Yeah, that would help also. And then a better question would be, now asking, while you're using our product, what tool or application, what sort of assistance do you use to discover the need? Yeah, I've tried to do currency exchange, and then the thing is you don't really show the history. From the app, I have to have this currency exchange app open so I can check, am I changing at the low point, the high point, you see? Now you discover a need, yeah? Okay, next one. What do you feel about adding a feature, blah, blah, blah? And this one, do not ask. It's guiding questions, yeah? And the next one, how do you feel about our run Riga? Again, do not ask. Why not? Because you see, when you're interviewing people, you only have the precious 30 minutes. Normally, I recommend do not go beyond 45 minutes. If you talk to an Italian, for instance, how do you feel about run Riga, blah, 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 after 20 minutes, you're nowhere, yeah? So therefore, do not ask these type of questions. And also, again, when you're doing interview or having face-to-face conversation, people are nicer than they are. Yeah, you will not meet people immediately. It's garbage, yeah? Okay, and next one, what factor do you consider when you select a sports app? And then again, see the ideal you? Yeah, when I select an app, I think about this, I think about that, and now you want to ask? Okay, tell me about your last sports app you selected. Tell me about it, and then you can discover, oh, she considered this, that, instead of, again, what I think I do. Yeah? Okay, now to summarize. Okay, so now they're all bad, okay, hold on, yeah? Okay, some tips. So first, ask powerful questions, ask open questions. Do not ask, for instance, if I ask you, is your breakfast salty? I'm forcing you to think about your breakfast, nothing else, but whether it's salty. Yeah, a little bit. It doesn't tell you much. That doesn't tell you anything. Ask open questions, such as, how was your breakfast? Yeah, and now you think, yeah, okay, breakfast, I had cereal, I had bagel, I had a fried egg, I had bacon. Now you see, information comes in. Next one, never, never, never talk about the new feature you plan to introduce or a new product idea. People will tell you yes. Yeah, so don't bother to do it. If you want to do it, you just call me, I tell you yes, that's it. Yeah? And next one, and ask about their real life experience. Remember, there's a real you, there's an ideal you. Don't ask about ideal you, ask about the real you. Yeah? Okay, so then let's move to the next one. So MVP, build, measure, learn, we're all familiar. How many of you are working with this? Okay, good. Okay, so now we know that we have an idea, and to be sure, I want to ideally build something to help me to test so that I can learn. So build, measure, learn. Based on my learning, I can make a decision. Yes, that I'm even more confident it's going to fly, or nobody seemed to like it, and then I ditch the idea. So that is where we talk about the build, measure, learn. And then what happened? In most of the company I coached when I went in, and then what happened? And then normally they're doing this. From very far, look very much the same, right? And then now we zoom in, what happened? They do build, and build, and build again. Yeah. Well, why do they do? They always talk about, oh, okay, when are we going to release our next MVP? Yeah. And what they meant is a release. If you ask them, I tried, every time I go, when I hear people talk about it, and I ask them, okay, great, you have an MVP releasing today on Friday. What do you plan to learn? What are you talking about? We're releasing this and that. You see, the whole learning message is lost when you do build and build and build. Yeah. And that is, unfortunately, most companies are doing that. So for people, it's more minimum viable product is more the kind of minimum, the smallest we can release. The whole idea is changed. Yeah. And then therefore, which is why if you Google, you will hear people, some people start to talk about minimum learning product. You see, that's all where these different names come in. MVP, MMP, MLP. It doesn't matter. You see, the key is to really understand why do they talk about build, measure, learn? What value and how should we do it? Yeah. And then, oh, this goes a bit fast again. Yeah. So therefore, talking about build, measure, learn, and here what is important is that when you start to do a circle, you should really know what are you trying to measure. Not only that, you also want to minimize the effort of building. Why? Because I'm not confident. If I'm not confident, ideally, if I can spend €1 to know, I can either gain more confidence or know it's not an idea that's going to fly. That would be much better than spending €10. That's why there are so many different ways of MVP, such as concierge MVP. I don't build anything. What do? I actually do this manually. I don't build the product. I do it manually again to get the learning, to test it, get the data to learn. And there's also things that, such as Wizard of Oz. Some of you, I would assume most of us have watched the movie. So, okay, from the front end, for you as a user, you feel Evelyn has this product. And in the back end, when you enter your data, we have a file that's saved. I click open. Okay, then I'm going to do it again manually. So all in all, you try to minimize your effort if possible and try to test and get the measurement so that you can learn. That's the entire MVP circle. Yeah? And now talking about the test, if you look at Google, so Google had their reasons to test 41 shades of blue, and Yahoo also have their special reasons. However, for us, normally when working on product, a few suggestions. Number one, A/B testing is great. Yeah? So it helps us test our hypothesis. So we have controlled group A and B and C. How far do you want to go? Do you do A, B, C, da, 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 all the way to Z? Or what do you do? So normally the recommendation would be you want to limit on the number of variations. You don't normally want the 2, 3 is good. 3, 4 is okay. 4 and 5, you'll be a little bit cautious. Yeah? And then also you have to know what to measure. Then the next two words are very important with numbers. I have seen, again, my clients, they show me what they did before I came in, and to say, oh, with better engagement, how do you know there's better engagement? Yeah, so therefore you have to have numbers. We're really looking for numeric numbers, and that's very important. And Spotify model, very popular. Yeah, so 2011, 2012, a couple coaches working there, they did their speeches and videos, everybody is inspired. And now the problem is that because I run coaching programs for coaches, so I actually have coaches I'm coaching from 51 different countries, so I kind of know what, you know, each continent is doing. Now Spotify model is not really model. If you talk to Hendrik, and he will say, well, we don't really have a model, this is just how they work. Yeah, now if you talk about Spotify model, and then all over, we talk about all the way to New Zealand, Australia, Asia Pacific, everywhere else, North America here, and Europe, everybody is talking about Spotify model. And then also, now what happened is that, you know, in Spotify model, just now, if you're familiar, there's a team, they don't call their teams Scrum team, they call their team Squad. Yeah. And then what happened? They changed, company changed their team name to Squad. You, so therefore, changing your team name without doing any real changes doesn't help. However, I see this often. I have a client, last year they tried very hard to get me. I said the earliest I'll be available is in February. Finally, I went in. They said, well, we have 75 squads, yeah? And we also have 75, oops, okay, so the model show up, which is good. Oops, now disappeared. Okay, so we have 75 squad, goes this way, yeah? And then also, as you see, every squad that you would have also the product owner that's on top, yeah? So therefore, they have 75 squad, 75 product owners. And when I went in, I did the leadership coaching, I met a few HR BPs. And then when I asked, how are you guys doing? And then all of them were giving me one consistent message. Very busy, we're hiring a lot of people. And they're hiring a lot of product owners so they can have this Spotify model. And that doesn't help you to become more agile. Instead, what's going to happen is that having one PO per team or per squad, if you really want to call it that way, and may not work for you. You have to think about what is your product. So the first thing, before you start to transform, and also it's never too late to think about it, is to think about what is a product for you. And that's very important. And then maybe, for instance, I coach two product owners, they're working with 8 teams. You don't need one product owner per team. Yeah? And then, therefore, okay, oops, too fast. Okay. Okay, now we're going to look at the message again. Changing the name doesn't help. And you don't really need to have one PO per team. You have to think about what's your product. Yeah? Maybe you have, for instance, for the type of product you have, one PO can work with 3 teams. Yeah? When you learn better, maybe, for instance, there are quite a few. I have a few German product owners. They're working with 3 teams, 5 teams. They're all happy. And so therefore, what happened? If you start to work with 70, you hire product owner, now you have 75 product owner, 75 team, and then what happened? You, in short, you might be creating problems that you have to solve in the very near future, when you know better. All of a sudden, you have 75 product owner, what do you do with them? It's not just a PowerPoint slide, you do delete. It's not Excel file, you know, you delete. What do you do? There are persons like you, like me. What do you do with them? Yeah. So that makes things very difficult. That's also why many companies, you know, take a very slow progress in transforming. Why? There's a lot of human factor in there. When there's one person, assume for instance, I have my own company. If it's only myself, I can make any decision I want to make. If now I partner with her, two of us, yeah, we can do this. Let's do it. That's still easier. Now think about it, from 2 people to 20 to 200 to 2,000. If, for instance, now, if you get a text message or phone call and tells you, oh, we have organization structure change back in your office, you will certainly try to sneak out and try to figure out what's the change. And then bottom line, you're trying to figure out what's there in for you, how is it going to impact you. So there is a complexity from human factor will go in there. So therefore, having situation as such, that's going to slow down your progress. So always try to start as lean as possible. Figure out what you need, then you can add. But if you start with everything, what happened? You probably will be much fatter even after a few years than you should. Okay, value flow. Value flow is a very good concept. So therefore, what happened? We want to think about, okay, from order, the moment the customer is talking about, now we want to figure out their need. Yeah, customer to customer, let's look at the end-to-end flow. And Toyota is the first one, they call it order to cash. For them, what do? The moment you come in to order a Toyota, they will make it for you. And then the moment they deliver, you pay cash. You see order to cash, what do? They try to, of course, that'll be the best. Yeah. So eyes on the value object. And then it's a very good concept. And then how do you feel about this? So one company I went in and they were telling me, yeah, we're doing value flow. Yeah, we're doing all this. Again, I was again very happy for a moment. And then I zoom in. Yeah, now if we zoom in together, what do? So if you zoom in and you start to see the organization silos. So the value flow, the name is right, the content is wrong. So what happened? They have their still continued siloed structure. And then what happened? And they have to make sure it can connect. And now they might actually create extra pieces in the organization structure just to make sure things actually flowing. And then what happened? As a result, when I talk to their product owner, their development team, and what is the big challenge with this? Dependency. A lot of dependencies, and team felt frustrated, and product owner is frustrated, everybody is frustrated, and then I had a workshop with product owners, scrum master, and some key person, and then for them, one single message, we were able to deliver smoothly before. With the change, with this value flow change supposed to be better, we have so much trouble to deliver, a lot of frustration. So therefore, again, concept is good. Again, changing the name, before you do that, really think about, okay, what exactly is the concept? It may be you cannot do this direct end-to-end yet. Take smaller steps, one at a time, so that at least, say, every quarter, every half a year, we take a snapshot, we will see differences, we will see improvement. Instead of saying, let's do it. And then, do it this way, you just really generate frustration, and also for any change in change management, we call this foreign factors. Any single foreign factor come in, what happened? Our productivity go down. So therefore with this, as you can imagine, it's difficult. Why? Because it changed already. For this situation, do you change again? It's a very sensitive and difficult question. You have to really test it again and again, and you put yourself again in a difficult situation you didn't have to be in. Yeah. Okay, and the next one, again, value flow summary. So think about how to create a business agility. You see, the whole concept of order to cash is to think about, okay, how we can actually make decision late, deliver fast, and so that we know more information, we make better decisions. So that's why Toyota try to do this. Of course, Toyota started with a different reason, which is they had, back after Second World War, they were very poor. They didn't have enough money. They had resource scarcity. And how poor were they? When I went to Japan, visited Toyota, I saw the old video clip from back then. Workers were standing there doing nothing. Why? They didn't have metal pieces to produce any parts for the car. So for them, they said we couldn't afford to have many cars produced waiting for you to buy. We couldn't produce cars with bad quality. Then you come back. Hopefully, order to cash, you take your car. You don't come back until you need your second car. You see? And that's why. And then now if we think about us, it's a great concept. However, you want to think about how you actively start to make improvement, have true value flow. And again, calling it the flow again. See, inspiration is good. However, just changing the name, start to put something together, it doesn't work, unfortunately. It's actually, I see more drawback. Maybe it could have been better you stay the way you were if you make changes as such. And then now, again, a tool that's called value stream mapping. And some companies start to look into it already years ago. And again, it's a very, very good concept. And then now I use an Ericsson example. Back in 2011, I was a coach and internal organization. And then for them, remember, Ericsson is such a big company. So every little organization, when we say little, we're looking at a few hundred people, thousands minimum. And they have their own way of working back then. So when I was talking to them, then I said, okay, so what are some practices, some tools you have used, just to understand where they are? Oh, we use blah, blah, blah. One of them was value stream mapping. And then and I asked them, what was the last time you did it? Oh, that was early. That was just 3 years ago. Yeah. So number one message, value stream mapping is a great tool, is you use it continuously for continuous improvement. It's not a one-time application. You use it, you drop it. Instead, what do you do? This is where we are now. Through the exercise, you will know, okay, ideally, I should be here. And then you make some improvement, and we know our system is complex, so therefore what happened? Ideally, I want to be there. Maybe you actually end here, which is perfectly okay. What do? You do another value stream analysis. Again, currently I'm here, now, okay, ideally I can be here, and maybe I ended up here, and again, it doesn't matter, you see, these two help you continuously improve by doing so, so you always have the understanding of your current state and your ideal state, and you continuously improve, yeah. And so therefore, if you look at value stream mapping, and then green is here, the term is called a value, so activity, that are generating value for customer. And then the gray part is called a waste. In Lean, we call this non-value adding activity. Here, we're not distinguishing the difference between non-value adding activity but required, we have to do it, or non-value adding activity completely. For instance, I have a team that's in Riga, that's in Tallinn, that's in Stockholm, that's in Montreal. Oh, of course, we have to collaborate, have meetings, synchronization meetings, so that we can deliver. And that is called a non-value adding activity, but required because for whatever reason, we are in this setup. Yeah. And there are also other things that's called non-value adding completely. For this, we're not distinguishing them, so they're all waste. They're all gray. So now, current state, look at it, it looks good, huh? It looks okay. So at least exercise to start with where you are, current state. And then this is current, after, it's shorter, huh? Looks good, no? Yeah. Okay, you're probably waiting, yeah, what's the trap? Okay, so then what happened? Now we put them side by side and we'll compare. What is the problem now? Yeah, so we are focusing on the easier part, which is trying to code faster, trying to test faster. The things we do that is already adding value to customer, we're trying to speed them up. From the end result perspective, what happened? It is true, order to cash is getting a bit shorter, yeah? However, what is the challenge? You have so much more potential you didn't work with. And working on the gray part, the waste, is challenging. However, it gives you more gain. No pain, no gain, which is why sometimes when I coach, people laugh at me, and normally I ask them, how do you guys feel about it? Yeah, we feel good. And I said, okay, that means not good enough. Let's look at it again. Yeah, we feel a little bit challenging, a little bit uncomfortable. That's where we should go. Yeah. So no pain, no gain. You have to feel, you know, it's difficult in a way, to a certain extent, to say, yeah, let's look at it. The key about value stream mapping is to eliminate or minimize waste, which is the important part. Yeah. Okay. Some takeaway message: continuous improvement with continuous application. Again, you use it, and you make sure For some of us here, many of you might be working as Scrum Master, Agile coaches or managers. You want to bring a tool as such, a good tool to work. You want to make sure having it done the first time certainly is, you know, a good success. And to really make sure it's a true success that will help your company, you want to make sure to make that as a periodic activity. So you're continuously improving. Yeah? And then help us identify and eliminate the waste is really the key value of a value stream mapping. That is very important. Yeah? Very powerful, only with a little condition if you use it right. Otherwise, you might be one of the organization I spoke to, they will say, yeah, we did it, but it didn't really help us much. It will help you if you use it right. Yep. Okay, takeaway message. And first, there are so many inspirations. I could stay here for the rest of the day, maybe tomorrow as well, talk about all the other inspiration. I just picked a few. So that kind of cover from end to end, different faces. And there's so many great inspirations. Really understand why, going back to the basics, why did they do it? And why did they help? And what's their situation? You know, Spotify didn't just all of a sudden change their name, so all of a sudden they become more agile. There's a history behind it. There's a reason behind it. Yeah. And then also go back to the basics on how we should be doing it. When I run my coaching program, I coach product owner as well. And normally, I always ask them if it doesn't require NDA. Yeah, if you don't work with some of my customers, they're working in garment agency. So if that's the case, you don't need to bring in too much complication for me to review your stuff. If not, send me the content you use. If you say you're doing interview, if you say you're doing this, hypothesis-driven development, HDD, sounds cool, sounds fancy, and let's look at that together, and then what happened? The whole part always need quite a lot of improvement. Yeah, so therefore, understand why, understand how. Really go back to the basics. Yeah. And then, that's a good inspiration, isn't it? Yeah. So climb up Mount Everest, I tried as well. I only stopped at base camp one. And then still, wow, that's so inspiring. And here, the important message is get inspired. Look around and learn, like, you know, attending conferences and hear what people are using, how they practice, how they improve, and then get inspired. However, again, try not to, do not mimic. Pure copy does not work. Yeah. So therefore, try not to mimic instead, and really look into how, really look into why. Because if you just go with mimic, and you will actually start to build a psychological prevention line. What is that? Is that the moment we start to talk, yeah, okay, we do this, we do that, you see, we're doing everything. And then the conclusion you draw will be, we are special. You heard that, right? Yeah, our product is special. Our organization is special. Yeah. And that actually prevents you from improving. Yeah. So that is all I have. And then I think about coaching every day. I think about Agile every day as well. So therefore, that's my email address, my name as well. And then if you come to Stockholm, let me know. That's a picture now, changing from Riga to Stockholm. And oh, feel free to drop me an email and get connected. Yeah. Thank you very much.